Hi, and welcome back to the people stage. We did have a slight technical hiccup a little bit ago, but it's not a tech conference without a tech hiccup. So with that, we're going to continue our program this afternoon, and I'd like to welcome to the stage now Dr. Malika Khoja for her presentation, which I'm very much looking forward to. And I'd also love to celebrate that today she is officially a doctor. So congratulations, Malika, and the stage is yours.
Thank you so much, Sarah, for that. Can you hear me properly?
Yes, you sound great.
I just want to share my screen if you can confirm that you can see my screen.
Here we see your screen, and here come your slides. Perfect.
Okay, I'm just gonna put it in the full mode. Can you see my screen
yes.
now? Okay. Thank you, Sarah, for the introduction and the congratulations announcement and so on. I'm so glad today was a very overwhelming day, getting my degree, having to help with the typing and then presenting at the People Track. So it's been very exciting. So thank you for giving me the opportunity to share with you my story, my journey at the People Track led by you, Sarah, and then speaking about finding the niche and the making one's mark in AM. Where did I come from and how did I end up in the AM industry? And then just, I love this from Brené Brown, that say, one day you will tell your story of how you overcome what you went through, and it will be someone else's survival guide. So I hope that a bit of my story can be a guide to someone's one day. So coming all the way from North Africa, Algeria, raised and born and raised there, and then finishing my studies up to the master's level, and then moving up to South Africa to complete my PhD study doing experimental work. I feel like I'm Algerian by blood and South African by heart, and then bridging my presence from the north to the south. So just to tell you a bit of my background, as I mentioned earlier, I finished my master's studies in aerostructure engineering, at the mechanical department of the University of Sidi Bel Abbès, a city in the west of Algeria. And then moving here to South Africa in 2015 to finish my PhD project on a national grant from my government that was given for 11 months. Then I end up finishing the grant without even being starting the project. And my project was on aircraft crack repair, and it was very interesting project. I did it at the Council for Scientific and Industrial Research. And as you mentioned, I'm grateful that I was able to finish, because after my grant finished, I had to work then, finish my studies freelance, you know, my engineering skill. And then in the same time doing my PhD. So it was a very tough and long journey. So I'm very grateful that I'm done with that chapter to carry on and move on with my life. And then one of the important achievement as well, and my passion as well, being advocating for women empowerment, coming from a culture that women are underrepresented, even though they are educated and so on, they are still don't have a big say in their culture. So advocating for women and joining women in 3D printing, initially as an ambassador in South Africa, then after a few years became the Africa chair of the global organization to actually expand my effort beyond South Africa. It was also overwhelming, and I will showcase a bit of my puzzle there at this beautiful organization. And then one of my biggest achievement is co-founding and managing the Tiziri Advanced Manufacturing Technologies here in South Africa. And I will tell you a bit about it there, where the niche, finding the niche came from for me to be in AM and make a mark and position and a voice for myself, especially a foreigner in another country. So where I started my passion about 3D printing, I mentioned I was at the Council for Scientific and Industrial Research to come do experimental work on my PhD. And there, interacting with different research group, I went to the National Laser Center just to see what they are doing. I had a meeting there. Then they introduced me to their group that do additive manufacturing, where they actually that group have there has have developed the world largest metal powder bed fusion printer. And then you can see on my left here that you can see the size of the printer. That's me. So it's very liberative. And then compared to the one I'm standing on the right, which is the SLM solution machine, they were as well. After I got introduced to 3D printing and then witnessed the printing of titanium on that machine, then my passion grew there and I wanted to know more about it and went and read about it and stuff. Still busy with my research work then. Then from there, when I finished my internship at the CSIR, I went in a joint private company that a service bureau in the additive manufacturing, and I did an internship and acted as a business development engineer. And that actually opened up a lot of things for me because I was putting my nose in everything from the process, from material handling to the design, to the printing, post-processing, removing support and stuff, talking to client, taking parts to the client, and so on. So that's opened up a whole new world for me and a new perspective on how business is, how technology it is from a research perspective, from a commercial perspective. So it was a very eye-opening. And then from there, after I finished my internship, and then I had to still support myself financially in order to be able to finish my PhD as well. Then after my experience from research, academia, and then as well commercial work in the industry of additive manufacturing, and then that company was using powder bed fusion, and then I got introduced by myself learning about all the other technologies, I thought, yeah, this technology is very diverse, a lot of application, and you touch base on anything from different sector, railway, medical, aerospace, automotive, you just name it, you will find additive application in any sector. So, and then what I have noticed that AM is known in South Africa. However, there's a lack of awareness about the other technologies. Like, as we know, technically, there is 7 processes of additive manufacture of 3D printing according to the ASTM standard. However, like we find in few countries that they only know about the bed fusion and extrusion and so on. So there where the, you know, and then there is a lack of awareness about it. There where the niche and make finding the niche for me to start working. So before I was doing freelancing, offering my engineering expertise to industry to support myself, then I said, why don't I make that official? And I do it on a professional level. And then from there, I came up with the idea of creating T-Ziri Advanced Manufacturing Technologies with my business partner. And I said, but we need to do something different. You know, there is a lack of awareness about technologies. There is, you know, a lot of potential, but we see only few application, few adoption and implementation. So there where we came up with the idea, let's do training and consultation, let's educate the people of the technology through this perspective and raise awareness and grow the interest and the market. Then we will show local manufacturer the advantage of additive manufacturing, and then that so they can use it to their advantage based on their needs. So that's what we say as well. We, through our consulting and training, we deliver the right fit technology to our client, because we have, as well from my experience, I have learned that people like only know, you know, the 3D printing word. They don't really know much in details what's really matter in the technology, which process work for which sector and which application. And we can find one sector that can use many processes, so that depend on the application you are using. And then as well there, we partnered with international companies from Europe and America on a training from a training perspective as well, being agent of those companies to sell their hardware and software. And then as well, we didn't want to reinvent the wheel and then as well showcase what's already been here in South Africa. So we said, if we're partnering with partners, need to be strategic. So we look to technology that are not or underrepresented in the African market. And we went and we had discussion and we partnered with them. And then we started representing such, you know, a direct energy deposition and wire arc additive manufacturing. And then we looked to the whole supply chain from powder, software and industrial metal printer until post-processing there as well. We represent a company where we look to surface finishing. And then as well, through dealing with clients, small project, big project here and there and hustling as well, especially with the difficult economy in Africa, not a lot of funding, being foreigner as well is difficult. I learned another skill, which is market research. I had a better understanding on what is 3D printing industry looks like in the African terrain. It's not necessarily the same of what's happening in Europe and Asia and America. So as well there, we look to make a space for ourselves where to know the market, who is doing what, who is doing where, which process they are using. And then as well, that led our company to be for 2 years consecutive a contributor to the Vola report. And that's as well show of that we are in a right path through our startup. So I'm very proud of that. And as well, I never thought that I would be in the entrepreneurship world because it was not in my mind. But sometimes being in a survival mode, it pushes you to be creative and entrepreneurial, and then you need to make it there as well. So, and then having a passion about it, it just make it easier to go through the hurdles and bear the challenges and the obstacles. And then coming back to my journey in women in 3D printing, being advocating for women empowerment there, I said I came from a culture that women are second best thing, and in general, Africa is like this, whatever is the propaganda saying, you know, with woman empowerment and so on. So being passionate about 3D printing, then seeing women in 3D printing and the amazing work is doing across the world, I say, why not Africa? And then there where I spoke to Nora. And I said, can we do something about Africa? Can we bring this community to found a platform for women and in the 3D printing aspect so they can go to and then they can have the support? And this is just a few pictures of some of the events I have organized through women in 3D printing and the positive interaction we got from people. And the funny thing always is like, can men attend women in 3D printing? But that's what we say, women in 3D printing, it's not a woman club, but it is open for everyone. And then just like trying to close the gender gap, and actually through women in 3D printing, through my working at the TZD Tech, actually I learned new skills about me that I didn't know. And as well, just coming from Algeria, not speaking English and choosing South Africa to do my internship, it was very challenging because I couldn't even express myself. And people thought, this woman coming from Algeria, she's very stupid. So So starting to speak English like without schooling at 2015, I think there I also made a mark myself to improve and being resilient and persistent about learning new things, you know, and not letting other people get me down and so on, and persevere for what I want. I wanted to make a mark myself. I thought I would be doing it in my research area that I started my PhD, my aeronautical engineering, but I think my passion with 3D printing led me to another career path. And the growth that I had in the past 4 years, I haven't experienced it like like 15 years ago, and then I would haven't achieved it if I didn't travel and open my mind. And then one of the one of the key skills that I discovered about myself that I didn't know about, that networking is a key element. And then as well, I found that collaboration is the new innovation. So getting people together and talk and network and share experience. And then what's the amazing part of it is like the 3D printing in general globally is very humble and sharing community. So that as well helped. But it wasn't an easy journey emotionally as well, especially studying at the same time. So there I want my story to be at least maybe example to someone else doubting themselves, coming from different background, going to a new background, to not let that stop them from going further and pursuing their passion. And then even like, it is not necessarily what you study, that's what you will be working on. So just follow your passion, and if you are doing something, do it good. And then from there, you will excel at it. And then you will find a new other ground that you will grow at it. So this is more or less my journey. It's not like that's impressive, but that's my advice is for people, if you want to have a career in AM, whether having your own company or working at other people's company, just find what you are good at and what is as well is not done, and then you can you see yourself that you can do it better, you can improve it. So just put your nose in the thing and learn it and do it. And for me, perseverance is the main thing that I have. And as well, same with the PhD, I always told them PhD is not a scale of intelligence, it's a scale of perseverance. The fact that you take up that journey, it's a huge step. And as today, keynote speech from Sarah this morning talking about the Everest, I was like in the background saying like my PhD was my Everest, I'm not gonna do any other Everest again. So I'm very happy that I shared my experience and my journey. And I want to for every woman and girl up there, learn and take it, be grateful, and then network, be resilient, and then share and ask. Don't be shy to ask, because if you ask, you get a yes and a no. If you don't ask, the answer is always no. So always go there, go be a go-getter and make your mark in 3D printing, and then learn from other people's experience. Volunteer with other people. That's even though that you don't get paid, but you will get experience and characters and skills that you may not known about yourself. So that's more or less my journey. I don't want to make it longer. So thank you for listening to me, and I hope that my story can be examples to other, to not give up, never give up, carry on, and everything ends. You know, I thought my PhD would never end, but at the end it ended. So and I'm looking forward to the future, to make a bigger impact in the additive manufacturing industry. And one of my biggest passion is I want to contribute to the medical field in additive manufacturing. So I want to see myself there making more impact, even though I have worked with few projects in 3D printing for implants, for people, for prosthetic and people with cancers and so on. So I want to go to that space and contribute much to it. So I just want to say, go woman and do it. And the fact that Taipei is powered by women in 3D printing is just showcase how women can do a lot in the 3D printing. And then as well, giving them visibility is, I believe it's a very important element to empowerment. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Malika. That was fantastic. And I know I'm not nearly alone, especially looking at the chat, to find your entire journey just very inspiring. We do have a couple of questions coming in for you. So first, we have one just kind of looking at the industry in Africa. So the first question we have for you is whether women in North Africa, are women in North Africa involved with additive manufacturing? And are there differences in comparison with South Africa?
Yes, definitely, like a huge differences in the involvement and so on. I can get it to you, there is not even one metal 3D printer in Algeria. And then, so there's not a lot of women that are involved. The government is pushing for women empowerment through education. However, there is, you know, a limitation on what the available funding to get such equipment, but things are changing. But here in South Africa, like the government has a big mandate on women empowerment and giving funding for businesses, especially businesses that are 4IR driven. And we know that 3D printing is one of the 4IR pillars. So, and then, that's why one of my passion is like actually education, coming from academic background and bridging between South Africa and North Africa and Algeria. I want actually to transfer the skills that I have learned here, the market, the industry as well, through education and through business, and introduce this technology to in my country to implement. Basically, a lot of people know about 3D printing, but adoption and implementation is something else. So it's very important to include the 3D printing in education, research and development. So definitely I want to make my mark there as well.
That's fantastic. And I think education and, you know, support from the government and helping to build access to that education is so important. So well pointed out. We have another question in for you. It's an anonymous one asking, what 3D printing technique do you think has the best opportunity to develop and grow in the coming years in Africa, considering the industry, applications, and costs?
Very nice question. And actually, that's one of the niche that we have found through our company, that, you know, the African terrain is different. We have a lot of industry, oil and gas, energy, shipyard, and African infrastructure is very old. So we need a lot of spare parts and replacement. And we identify wire arc additive manufacturing from the CNC machines concept is very useful for the African terrain. So we see a big potential that actually it will change the way manufacturer do their manufacture their spare part and decrease the lead time. So I think that's the technology that's showing potential in the African terrain, and it will grow much, much better, because especially in South Africa, we see a big presence of powder bed fusion, but then with the powder bed fusion, we all know the size limitation and the support structure limitation and so on. So wire arc additive manufacturing being on multi-axis and close to the net shape, so that, and you can print a big component, I think that's very suited for the African terrain. So that's the technology I see that's growing, that would be growing fast.
Fantastic. I'm not seeing any more questions in the Q&A. Anyone can add another one, but one thing I'm curious, I know in South Africa, you do have a lot of kind of planned power outages, and there tend to be kind of power disruptions in several countries in Africa. How does that affect industry when you're working with heavy equipment like industrial 3D printers?
Yeah, just the power generation company, it has a lot of downtown on and maintenance on their machines and so on. So that's affecting the power generation company itself. And it's very bad. We're trying to raise awareness to such companies to show that maintenance and using 3D printing for spare time to decrease the downtime and so on. But there is a lot of resistance because there is a lot of corruption. It's Africa. It's not easy to get government contracts. So we just have to suffer. And sometimes we get load shedding schedule like 2 hours and sometimes 4 hour day. And sometimes the load shedding lead to cable theft. Then it as well lead to cable damage. Then you sometimes you suffer a week without electricity in your region. So I believe 3D printing can change a lot of things, and I hope that in Africa we can embrace and implement additive manufacturing in a very good positive that will improve the quality of our living and our, you know, efficiency, especially for the economy, because it's very costly. It costs the country a lot of millions because of that. So yeah, so that's Africa, but that's as well as about African. We make something out of nothing, so that's what keeps us going.
So speaking of starting something out of nothing, we have another question in about the work you've been doing with your community for women in 3D printing. She says, thanks for the inspiring talk. How many women usually attend your events, and how has that changed over the last year since you established the chapter?
So I established the Women in 3D Printing chapter in 2018, and the first event had 20 people, and then as well the event varied from the theme, because sometimes we just have casual meetups and come together, chat what you're doing, 3D printing, this and that. And sometimes I organize workshop and then factory visit, there the number goes up and so on. Then and then it gets very engaging and people get very curious, and then actually that facilitates a lot of networking and initiate a lot of collaboration. You will not believe how it is, because the community is very small, and it is wonderful. And then as well it extend their network to the global network, which they like it. And then something happened, like with 2020 COVID happened, actually we got more we're doing virtual happy hours, we got more attendance, and not only from South Africa, across the globe, and then as well Africa. So that's a positive thing from COVID perspective, that COVID impact on community. But it's growing very well. At the beginning it was very, very slow, but then when people know really what is the message, what's Intel, they really actually get engaged and start helping, start connecting. So I'm looking forward to do more work, especially being the Africa chair. And as me, I was the first to open the local chapter in Africa in general. So now we're having more than six chapter across Africa, Kenya, Nigeria. And then we are looking for a few chapter in North Africa. So I'm really excited about that role that I'm playing, because I believe in that other women, by empowering other women, that will help them succeed. It will really reflect that's my success.
That's exactly right. And it's fantastic to see the community you've been growing and fostering and helping to encourage. And we're so thankful for all the work you've been doing, and it's amazing to see this technology growing across the entire continent of Africa.
Yes.
So thank you, Malika, for your time today. I really appreciate it. Congratulations again.
Thank you for inviting me and giving me the floor to share my story with everyone. And I'm hoping the best for you and for everyone. And go type day one, and looking forward to day two with the numbers we are looking at. It's such an amazing place and platform. Congratulations for all the work and the effort you've been working on with your team.
Thank you for everything, Malika, and thank you for everyone joining us today. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back with our last panel of the day for the People Track.